Hello and welcome back to the Legacy of Picard's Fleet. This is part two of a two-part series where we answer what are the legacies of the ships in this fleet. We covered a lot of ships last time in part one, which were mostly too damaged to actually make it to the Sector 9 incident after the Borg ship encounter, but there's still a whole bunch left to dig into. We've collected more details, lore, and information you might not know, so let's beam in and check out the legacy of Picard's Sector 9 fleet. Welcome to Trek Central. I'm your host, Sohail, aka Starfleet Boy. Before we warp into this video, if you want to keep up to date on all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure to hit the subscribe button to never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media for daily updates on the Star Trek universe. The USS Nathan Hale was an Inquiry-class starship and named after a famous 18th century American military officer and spy in the American Revolution. This wouldn't be the first time Nathan Hale is mentioned in Trek, with the Doctor referring to himself as No Nathan Hale in Voyager's episode Basics, Part 2. The USS Europa was a Luna-class starship named after one of Jupiter's moons, Europa. However, this was not the only Europa in Trek, as the USS Europa was the flagship of Admiral Brett Anderson in Star Trek Discovery, where it led the fleet at the Battle of the Binary Stars in negotiations against the fractured Klingon Empire, united by T'Kuvma. Unfortunately, the Europa, a Nimitz-class starship, was one of the first casualties of this battle, and the Klingon Federation War of 2256 to 2257, as a cloaked Klingon cleave ship was able to ram the Europa and the ship activated its self-destruct system. The USS Almagest was also a Sutherland-class starship, and seems to be named after the Almagest, a 2nd century treatise on the motion of stars and planetary paths, written by Ptolemy, and was considered one of the most influential scientific texts in history. Our hero ship of the show, the SS La Sirena, has its name being Spanish for the mermaid or the siren, with Rios showing a fascination for mermaids. This Kaplan freighter was manufactured at the Kaplan Schiffbau on the Hotzenplotz colony world, and would help Admiral Picard in his mission to find Bruce Maddox in 2399. The USS Helios was an Akira-class starship and was named after the Greek god of the sun. In Beta canon, there would be a USS Helios during the 23rd century with the Drexler-class USS Helios, which was a successor to the Daedalus-class. Interestingly enough, this USS Helios would have on board a young prime, Gabriel Lorca, serving as security chief on the vessel before serving a small stint at the Tarsus IV colony. And we all know what happened at Tarsus IV. There was also a class of tug ship called the Helios class, which were seen in Star Trek Discovery. The Gagarin class was a new starship and was the successor to the Shepard class from the mid-23rd century. The first ship of this class was the USS Gagarin, and was named after the Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin, to become the first human to journey into outer space. The USS Rubin was another Akira-class starship, and funnily enough was actually almost in the film Star Trek First Contact as a backup for the USS Thunderchild. The Rubin was named after Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rubin, who unfortunately was assassinated in 1995, but became a symbol of the Israeli-Palestinian peace process, as he was elected on the platform embracing Israeli-Palestinian peace, and he signed the Oslo Accords. Lee Soon-shin was a Korean admiral and military general famed for his victories against the Japanese Navy, with most of his military engagements being faced with low odds and overwhelmed by superior numbers, yet still emerging victorious. The USS Lee Soon-shin, a Ross-class starship, is named after him, though it is interesting that the ship named after him is a Ross-class, a variant of the Galaxy-class, a massive starship, and not a smaller ship like a Defiant-class, for example. Those who have watched Trek before know very well the USS Excelsior, the starship which originally was meant to have a transwarp drive as part of the Great Experiment, but then went on to being captained by Hikaru Sulu and would assist in the Khitmor Accords between the United Federation of Planets and the Klingon Empire. Not only would Sulu serve on the Excelsior, but so would Tuvok and Janice Rand. However, this USS Excelsior isn't the same Excelsior as the one we see in the Picard fleet had a different registry and was part of the Excelsior II class of starship, the direct successor to the Excelsior class. Not only is the Excelsior well known, but everyone knows Nyota Uhura. And our next ship, the USS Uhura, named after famous Starfleet officer Uhura, who served on the USS Enterprise under Captain Pike as a cadet, would serve under Captain James T. Kirk, and would then go on to be captain herself of the USS Lundgrens, a Lancelot-class starship which would have its own five-year mission to the Lesser Magellanic Cloud, during which the ship participated in over 100 first contact missions. The ship would then become a training vessel, and Uhura would remain captain, assisting in the training of Starfleet cadets, including a cadet Jean-Luc Picard. So obviously Uhura would get a ship named after her, and this ship is a Reliant-class starship. We've talked slightly about the Ross-class starship, but where would we be without the first ship in this class? Now, the interesting thing about the USS Ross is that its history starts off as the ship of a tabletop role-playing game series set in the Star Trek universe called Clear Skies. In this show, they made their hero ship being the USS Ross, and this ship would be designed by Thomas Maroney. In-universe, the USS Ross was a one-of-a-kind variant of the Galaxy class and originally had an NX registry, though by the time of Picard it would gain an NCC registry and be the first ship of an entire class, no longer one-of-a-kind. The Ross originally launched in 2381 and began a mission in the Shackleton Expanse. The ship was named after Mary G. Ross, the first known Native American female engineer. And talking of the Shackleton Expanse, we also have the USS Shackleton, named after British explorer Ernest Shackleton, who was one of the principal figures of the heroic Age of Antarctic exploration. The USS Shackleton was an Inquiry-class ship. The USS Ibn al-Haytham was named after the famous Arab polymath Ibn al-Haytham, who is regarded as the father of modern optics, with his most influential work being the Kitab al-Manir, a 7-volume treatise on optics and other fields of study. The USS Ibn al-Haytham was a Sutherland class and probably named due to the scientific capabilities of the Sutherland class, most notably the sensor dish on top of this ship class. The USS Okuda is a Sovereign class starship, and this ship was named after notable Trek creatives Denise and Michael Okuda. Denise being a scenery artist, and Michael most notably being the one who came up with the Okudagrams. The USS Christopher is a Gagarin-class starship with probably the least knowledge about its legacy. This ship could possibly be named after Christopher Columbus, the Italian explorer who is known for finding America, but mostly found the West Indies. The USS Magellan was an Inquiry-class starship named after the explorer Ferdinand Magellan, who was the first person on Earth to circumnavigate the globe. Now, the USS Thunderchild was actually seen in the film Star Trek First Contact and was an Akira-class starship which had previously served at the Battle of Sector 001, where a Borg cube was moving through Federation space toward Earth and a fleet of Federation starships was sent to intercept it. The Thunderchild was one of these ships and helped to destroy the Borg cube alongside other ships and the Enterprise E. The name Thunderchild came from the H.G. Wells novel War of the Worlds, where the HMS Thunderchild helped divert Martian fire to save transport ships evacuating civilians out of London. The USS Clark is an interesting one by its name. This could mean to be the USS Clark with an E, with a previous USS Clark being a Malachowski-class starship in the mid-23rd century, which took part at the Battle of the Binary Stars. However, as it isn't with an E, this ship could be named after Mark W. Clark, the youngest four-star general in the US Army, and the man who led the Fifth Army to capture Rome in 1944 during the Second World War. If there is another more obvious Clark which this ship may be named after, please let us know in the comments below. Another Sovereign class was the USS Hutchinson, named after presumably the most famous or infamous English woman in colonial American history, Anne Hutchinson. She is known for representing religious freedom in England's American colonies and the history of women in ministry, challenging the authority of the ministries. Again, whether there is another famous Hutchinson which the ship might be called after, please let us know. The USS Tyro, a Reliant-class starship, was named after Marcus Tullius Tyro, a freedman of Cicero and a writer in Rome. He wrote a considerable number of books and is believed to have invented an early form of shorthand writing, the Tyronian Notes. He wrote books on grammar, the scripts, speeches, and even jokes of Cicero and many other writings. Now, the next ship has a very interesting name, and that is the USS Firesword, with a badass-sounding name for an Akira-class starship. Now, what is interesting is that a flaming sword has been present in numerous legends and myths for thousands of years. From the Sumerian mythology with Asarludu, who ensures the most perfect safety, in Norse mythology with Surtur, to even Christianity and Buddhism, to name a few. So, an Akira class named after the fire sword to ensure safety makes a lot of sense and is a very apt name for an Akira class, and not just because it makes it badass. A Ross class starship would be named the USS Archer, probably after notable Starfleet officer, diplomat, and Federation president Jonathan Archer, who was captain of Earth's first Warp 5 capable ship, the NX-01 Enterprise, and for bringing all the disparate alien civilizations together to form the Coalition of Planets, which would eventually become the United Federation of Planets. Now, this isn't the first Federation ship to be named after Archer. With a Saladin-class looking ship, the USS Archer NCC-627, a small Starfleet ship captained by Una Chin Reli, better known as Number 1, during the Kylie's 274 incident in 2259. We did a breakdown of this ship recently if you're interested in this little, small Starfleet ship. A second USS Archer, NCC-44278 of an unknown class, was part of the Battle Group Omega, a group of Federation starships sent to intercept the USS Enterprise E and the Reman warbird Scimitar before the Scimitar could use its Thaleron weapon to destroy Earth. However, this battle group was ultimately unneeded as the E was able to destroy the Scimitar within the Bazon Rift with some good old-fashioned ramming maneuvers. The USS Hrothgar, a Sovereign-class starship, is named after the semi-legendary Danish sovereign of the same name. The king would appear in two poems, notably Beowulf and also Widsmith. In Beowulf, he was shown as the builder of the legendary Mead Hall and the one whose kingdom was under attack by Grendel and freed by Beowulf. Interestingly enough, King Hrothgar has appeared previously in Star Trek as a character in the Beowulf holonovel in the Voyager episode Heroes and Demons, where Grendel was actually a photonic life form which the Doctor managed to peacefully stop terrorizing the Mead Hall and in turn the USS Voyager. Our next ship is the USS Huygens, a Sutherland-class starship named after notable Dutch mathematician Christian Huygens, who is regarded as one of the greatest scientists of all time and a major figure in the scientific revolution. Huygens, as an astronomer, is chiefly known for his studies of the rings of Saturn and the discovery of its moon, Titan, where there would eventually be a colony in the Star Trek universe. Again, having a ship like the Sutherland, a very scientific vessel compared to other vessels in Starfleet, it is very apt to name it after such an important scientist. And talking about moons, we have the USS Luna, a Luna-class starship, and therefore the first ship of its class. This is obviously named after Earth's own moon, which in the 25th century has a thriving colony on it, with famous Starfleet officers like Jack Ransom being born there. This isn't the only first ship of its class, with the USS Akira also appearing in the fleet, obviously as an Akira-class starship. This class of ship was designed by Starfleet during the height of its concern about the Borg. It was a tactical vessel built in mind to combat the Borg threat after the disastrous Battle of Wolf 359. We recently did a video on these Borg combative ships designed by the Federation, so if you want to learn more, head over there with the link on screen now. And finally, we have the USS Enkidu, a Reliant class with its name being derived from the Epic of Gilgamesh and probably a sister ship to the USS Gilgamesh. Enkidu was a rival to King Gilgamesh, who tyrannizes his people, but they become friends and together slay the monster Humbaba. If this sounds familiar, then it is, as the iconic Trek episode Darmok, with its literally being mentioned in the episode. As Darmok and Jalad at Tanagra is like Gilgamesh and Enkidu at Uruk. And this literally is the story of that episode, two rivals who became close friends and slay a beast. What a fitting name for a Federation starship, and hopefully a legacy this ship goes on to honor, turning rivals into allies. And that concludes this video talking about the legacy that is the fleet in the second season of Star Trek Picard. Many Starfleet starships have legacies, whether they be in-universe or outside of the universe in our own history, but shining a light on both can be very illuminating indeed. So which of these ships is your favorite and why? Whether it be the new Sagan-class USS Stargazer for its legacy in-universe as the continuation of the Stargazer line, to any of these ships named after notable myths, legends, or scientists. What was your favorite ship in Picard's second season fleet? Let us know in the comment section below, because if you're talking about Star Trek, then we want to hear about it. If you want to see the next huge ship breakdown in the works, then make sure to hit the subscribe button to never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media or join our Discord server. For now, I've been Sohail, aka Starfleet Boy. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time. Live long and prosper, my friends.